she has immense power.
It's a tough job because there is no job description.
I'm glad to see you have come a long, long way.
The first lady's role is defined by what she wants it to be, and the public then has to accept that.
I've been awfully busy with arms control and the Russians, and
they had to walk a real tightrope.
Some of them get it, some of them don't.
Many of these men would not be where they are had they not been married to these women.
What is this role we call First Lady?
Almost all the first ladies in American history have made much more substantial contributions to the body politic than we, the American people, like to give them credit for.
It's not exactly a job. They don't get paid for it. And it's not an official position. There's nothing about it in the Constitution.
It's evolved from one of ceremonial importance in the early days of the nation to one of enormous political power today.
Each woman who crosses the threshold of the White House writes her own rule book, meets her own challenges, and even sets her own table.
Ultimately, the role of First Lady is that of national mother. We idealize them, we want the best from them, yet we feel absolutely free to criticize them and blame them for everything.
For two centuries, they've wielded unseen power in the White House, a power unique to them.
Talk, as far as I know, was a term first used by Betty Ford when somebody asked her what influence she had with the president.
They talk about the presidency being the bully pulpit. Well, you could talk about the first lady as being the pillow pulpit because she has immense power. She's the one who sees the president first and last every day, every night.
The American presidency is a crushing burden for any mortal. It's a cocoon, and the First Lady plays this vital role.
When you get to the White House, you've got people who say, yes, sir, and then you've got critics who scream and holler at you, and what you need more than anything else is someone who tell it to you straight, and in many ways, that's the role the wife plays.
I am only his wife. I do not influence policy. Well, if you believe that, you know, go build a bridge over swampland. I mean, it's just not true.
Presidents are just like anybody else. They want their wife to be there for emotional support. Strong men, that's the image they've got to show the world. Go back up in the family quarters. I think on occasion they curl up in little balls like the rest of us and say, Mama, can you just stroke me a little bit?
When we talk about the influence of a wife on a husband, the evidence is just too inaccessible. Only two people really know, and sometimes they may not recognize it, the influence of one on the other.
Whispered on a pillow, preserved in personal letters, or presented before a congressional committee, a First Lady's influence on her commander-in-chief also impacts her country, for better or worse.
Abigail Adams is a woman who not only stood out in her day, but still stands out today among all the first ladies with the legacy she left behind of hundreds of letters exchanged with her husband over the course of several decades.
Abigail and John Adams were real political partners. John had great respect for her. They called each other partner. They addressed each other in letters as dear partner. That's the way they felt about each other.
The other thing to remember about Abigail Adams is we have with us today still a popular public notion of her as this sort of revolutionary feminist.
Abigail was saying, remember the ladies trying to get us in the Constitution, which we still aren't in.
She tried to to get him during the Constitutional Convention to give women some rights, not the vote, not anything as radical as the vote, but property rights, some protection from abusive husbands. Unfortunately, he didn't listen to her about that.
In that period, in the 1790s, early 1800s, it's difficult to think of a first lady who had the same political power as Abigail Adams.
Somebody like a Mamie Eisenhower essentially hid their strength and the degree of veto power, if you will, that they had in their marriages.
I think at the time of the Eisenhower 50s, the country wanted a first lady like Mamie Eisenhower. She was not threatening. She represented the traditional wife.
Well, she was a very feminine woman, and she liked the color pink. She wore it well. Oh, everything was pink. By the way, I have a personal grudge against her because she wore bangs, and my mother thought that that was really in, so I ended up with bangs. It was not a good thing. Bangs and pink.
She was influential in having him distance himself from Joseph McCarthy. She felt very strongly that McCarthy's witch hunt about communism was going to come to reflect on Ike himself.
Ronald Reagan's problem was that he was so nice and he couldn't say no to anyone, and Nancy took it on herself to be the enforcer.
It was Nancy Reagan who could fire people around her husband that she thought weren't there in his best interest. If he was being hurt in her judgment, she could get him fired.
He trusted her political instincts enough to adhere to it. And if he thought she was right, they were out of there.
The most famous victim was White House Chief of Staff Donald Reagan.
Nancy Reagan was used to saying to the president's staff, I want this done for Ronnie. I think Ronnie's best interest would be served here. But Don Reagan, who had been the CEO on Wall Street and an ex-Marine, he didn't just roll over to that. He would say to her, well, Nancy, that's fine, but I think really what we ought to do is X rather than Y. And she didn't take to that at all. And the animosity grew.
Going as far back as 1985, when President Reagan was recovering from cancer surgery at Bethesda Naval Hospital, and Don Reagan commandeered the presidential helicopter to go see him. Pretty alarming.
After the Iran-Contra thing blew up, and Reagan was seen to be part of the problem by a lot of people around the president, she was determined that he should leave. Now, Ronald Reagan liked him. Two old Irishmen loved to tell jokes in the morning, exchange chatter. He didn't want to let him go.
In the end, it was really Mrs. Reagan who spoke to the president. She felt that he had really botched up the Iran-Contra scandal and clearly had to be sacrificed for the good of his administration.
The famous incident was that on the telephone, Nancy was talking to Don Reagan, and Reagan hung up on her. And when the word got out to the president that he'd treated his wife that way, that was it.
Mrs. Wilson became a gatekeeper for the president. That is, she made the decisions about who was going to see him and who wasn't.
He suffers a massive cerebral hemorrhage, a stroke, and is on the verge of death. And she meets with the doctors, the press secretary, and basically decides that they are going to conduct a sort of secret government.
She was very protective of her husband in a kind of Nancy Reagan way. And she knew there were people within the cabinet who wanted to declare her husband mentally incompetent and seize the power for themselves. And so what she did was she kept everybody away. My husband is too ill to see anyone. They were very reluctant to confront her. and then maybe have her say this had caused the president to get worse.
She decided that a great form of therapy for Woodrow would be if he stayed in the White House and she just took over the business of the presidency. So she basically spoon-fed the public very upbeat reports about his health being on the mend. Meanwhile, she was running the show.
She is the conduit for all of this for a period of 18 months. She had this wonderful entry where she says, "I myself made no political decisions. I only decided what was important and when to present it to my husband."
Many of those who had earlier opposed her were single-handedly isolated, alienated, or utterly removed, including the Secretary of State, who, when he conducted an emergency cabinet meeting without the president, found himself fired from his post. A Senate committee came to the White House to meet with the president and get a sense of his physical condition, and it was carefully arranged so the side that he had suffered the stroke on was not visible to them.
There was minimal scrutiny, minimal press coverage. The press consisted of a handful of very respectful gentlemen, basically did what they were told.
I don't think such a thing would ever happen today. We'd see it on television 24/7.
Did she go too far? Yes. Was that evil and pernicious and dangerous to the country? No. And I think that it's very easy to blame the woman. I think that some people who saw their influence for what it really was rather than what they thought it was blamed her for that.
Woodrow Wilson slowly recovered to complete his second term, but died just 4 years later in 1924. His last word was Edith. When Grace and Calvin Coolidge visited a Maryland chicken farm in the 1920s, farmers told Grace that their prize rooster could mate many times a day. She told the farmers, "Kindly inform the president." When Calvin was told, he asked if the rooster always mated with the same hen. Told many different hens, Coolidge responded, "Kindly inform the First Lady."
The questions raised, who elected her? Who decided that she should have anything to say about this?
I think Americans at the moment are still a little ambivalent about what the role of the First Lady should be, because we're in a transition about the role of women throughout our society. And I think they want a First Lady to be public. I think they want her to be out there. I think they want her to do things, but they don't yet want her to help run the country.
But the other side of the coin is many of these men would not be where they are had they not been married to these women.
Beginning, I think, with Martha Washington, there was a huge discussion about what the First Lady's role should be.
Martha Washington had a really tough job. I mean, nobody knew what she was supposed to do. He brought her in on the presidential barge. He said that the residence would also be the office. So she was drawn into the entertaining in a way that she wouldn't have been if he hadn't made such a fuss over her arrival.
She and George Washington came up with the idea of the First Lady as a ceremonial and social partner to the president. And so Martha actually pioneered that role, where together they hosted public events. And that set a precedent that allowed more politically active First Ladies to take a very positive role in politics.
Most First Ladies had used their power behind the scenes until Eleanor Roosevelt.
Mrs. Roosevelt visits a children's hospital to help the drive for $2 million.
Eleanor Roosevelt is the gold standard for the First Lady's role. She really transformed it because she was really the moral center which saw us through the Depression and the Second World War.
she went all over. She went down coal mines and she went to prisons. And she'd come back and she'd talk to him. Roosevelt would say to his cabinet ministers, well, my missus went to that project and she told me, or my wife told me she had been there and that's not what she saw at all. So she was very much his eyes and ears.
He would really get ticked off when she insisted after dinner, when he wanted to rest, on raising issues that she felt were important. But, you know, he would wave his hand and he'd say, all right, go ahead, just go into it.
At one point, her daughter, Anna Roosevelt, was watching her mother talk to her father and said, Mother, don't you realize that you're giving father indigestion? Just prior to going to the White House, Eleanor went to Franklin and said to him, I'd really like to help you. Could I take care of your mail? And he said to her, no.
She tells the New York Times that she never wanted to be a president's wife, that the thought of living in the White House filled her with the greatest possible sense of dread, that it was like living in a goldfish bowl, and that the White House ate women. So FDR really said to her, you have to stop. I want you to do teas and receptions. So Eleanor only really proves her political value to FDR when she goes to meet with the Army veterans who were living in tents, who had been fired upon by the Army in the previous administration. The next day, we get headlines in major papers with this quote, Hoover sent the troops, FDR sent his wife. And so FDR began to reconsider and to see what an asset she could be. She begins to travel with lightning speed around the country. And so people begin to see FDR through Eleanor. They hear FDR on the radio, but they see FDR through her.
She became involved in all kinds of social reform issues involving immigrant children, involving union workers, involving the equal rights of women. And she had a daily newspaper column, a weekly Sunday radio show.
She held news conferences. She held 392 of them.
In a nation such as ours, every man who fights for us is in some way our man. His parents may be of any race or religion, but if that man dies, he dies side by side with all of his buddies.
I think Eleanor revolutionized the First Lady's role by making it acceptable to be politically active and politically involved in your husband's political ambitions and indeed in the policies of the presidency.
I think that I am the person closest to the President of the United States, and if I can help him in understanding the countries of the world, then that's what I intend to do.
Jimmy and Rosalynn Carter had a very symbiotic relationship, very, very close. Right from the beginning, they worked together in the Carter family peanut business. The partnership continued through everything that they did.
She campaigned probably as hard, if not harder, than he did. So to get to the White House, she was indispensable. Jimmy was off balance when she wasn't around. Rosalynn would come back from a trip, and Jimmy would be so agitated, he would oftentimes not only meet her plane, but bound right up the flight of stairs to the plane. So there was a real dependency there.
The president asked her if she would go to South America. Now, other first ladies have been asked to undertake foreign trips, but not like this.
She went to talk about serious issues of consequence, and she met with individual presidents and prime ministers.
The first lady returned to Washington to mixed reviews.
She expected not to be a co-president, but to be a trusted advisor.
I'm going to convey all of this information that I have to Jimmy. In fact,
I look forward to consulting closely with him on a regular basis.
And she got a great deal of backlash from it because people felt, and probably rightly so, they hadn't elected the First Lady. They had elected the President.
The Constitution leaves it open to the President to seek his advisors. You remember, the cabinet is not written in the Constitution either.
I think it's all part and parcel of America's coming to grips with the gender gap closing, with equality for women in the workplace. The same thing applies to the White House. I think it makes people uncomfortable.
I suspect that the Carters also realized that she had reached a little too far. And in fact, Rosalynn Carter never made any more of those trips.
So what are we doing with this picture? All I know is I'm here. What is happening?
It's a Playboy.
Oh, good, good. Oh, right.
When President Clinton wins in 92, it's clear that Hillary's going to be a player. She's a lawyer from Yale. She helped craft some of the position papers that the campaign used. The president himself said, buy one, get one free. So anybody with an IQ over 2 knew that Hillary was going to be a player.
Thank you all very much.
She presented herself not just as a partnership in a marriage to a president, but as a policy wonk in her own right. And I think that was what set people on edge.
I'm here as an American citizen. I know from my own experiences that something is wrong with our health care system and that it needs to be fixed.
Of course she made herself a target. The plan that changed the way the nation's health system went came from not the president, but his wife. It was a shock.
Hillary Clinton, by taking on that role of healthcare reform, really did essentially signal a much more politically powerful, policy-oriented role than any First Lady had ever had before.
That is the kind of waste and inefficiency that permeates our healthcare system.
She held hearings, she gave speeches, and in order to get a bill of this magnitude through the Congress, she was going to have to give a little bit, and she wasn't willing to. So the bill went down to defeat.
It put all of the president's credibility on that issue on the line, and when health care reform did not pass, Hillary became that scapegoat because you could throw mud at her and have it stick and damage the president without throwing mud at the president.
Tonight's my greatest privilege to introduce to you the First Lady, Hillary Rodham Clinton.
Hillary is shrewd. She did not take on another major initiative to be a front person like she did with healthcare. But that doesn't mean that she stopped playing the game.
Mrs. Clinton did not stay in the shadows. She became the first ever First Lady to run for office and win. She became a U.S. Senator.
She changed the role of the First Lady, how a woman can be a career woman, have her own political ambitions, and be a devoted mother at the same time. So Hillary, in many ways, shattered the glass ceiling in the White House for the next generation.
Thanks. Thanks, everybody.
Enjoy it.
Bye-bye.
See you later.
Thank
you
so much. From the beginning, First Ladies have always championed worthy causes. Martha Washington gave money to war veterans. Grace Coolidge raised millions for the deaf. Nancy Reagan urged youngsters to just say no to drugs. And Lady Bird Johnson promoted the beautification of cities, something that Washington residents are thankful for every spring.
Jackie Kennedy was like an American queen, and people loved it. And it seems unfair that other women who wanted to be an American queen, like Nancy Reagan, were so bitterly criticized, and Jackie Kennedy got away with it.
The Kennedys were so young, they were so beautiful, and they were so worldly. Americans wanted to be them.
The country then had had 8 years of Dwight Eisenhower and Mamie. And Mamie was a kind of traditional first lady. She said, you know, Ike runs the country and I flip the pork chops.
I think Jackie surprised, first of all, her husband. When a Life magazine reporter said, may I spend a little time with Mrs. Kennedy? President Kennedy said, what do you want to talk to my wife for? She's out of it. Well, he learned his lesson.
The Jackie look was all over. It was a major phenomenon, and I don't know that the country had ever seen anything like it.
In fact, not just Americans, but people all over the world. The French were crazy about her. They met her at the airport, crowds chanting, Vive Jackie, Vive Jackie.
I am the man who accompanied Jacqueline Kennedy to Paris, and I've enjoyed it.
But it was more than the clothing style. It was her whole approach to the way she presented herself publicly.
He used her as an envoy to difficult heads of state. She could talk to de Gaulle about French culture in French. She could talk to Khrushchev about Russian history. And Nehru, she just dazzled with her beauty. Nehru was not impressed by this brash young president, but Jackie really smoothed the way.
But Jackie Kennedy, at age 31, was not the first to bring youth, style, and publicity to the White House. A century before, there was Julia Gardner Tyler.
She came to Washington for the social season, and everybody was in love with her. And President Tyler himself, his wife Letitia, had recently died. He fell head over heels in love with her.
Soon, the president was chasing 24-year-old Julia through the rooms of the White House.
Smitten, embarrassingly so. Congressman writing home about how the president is making a fool of himself. He should be more dignified. And Tyler, who was in trouble politically anyway, I suppose that he really didn't care.
Julia Gardner eloped in secret in New York with the 54-year-old president, John Tyler, who had married daughters with children who were actually older than Julia. It scandalized the nation. Julia relished every moment of it. She rode around Washington in a beautiful coach and decided that she should be called the presidentress.
They had seven children together. He'd had seven children by his first wife, so quite one of the biblical patriarchs in his progeny.
But the youngest first lady of all married an unlikely White House bachelor.
Grover Cleveland, who sort of had a big sort of walrus mustache and loved his beer and cheese, the rumors were that he was going to marry the widow of his former law partner.
Grover Cleveland was in a law partnership with Francis's father. When Mr. Folsom was killed in a carriage accident when Francis was 10 or 11, Grover Cleveland then assumed her guardianship.
Then all hell broke loose when it was discovered that he wasn't marrying Emma Folsom, the widow, but marrying instead her 21-year-old daughter, Frances.
But she is so young and so charming and so beautiful that she just captures everyone's heart.
And the nation became absolutely obsessed with finding out every detail about her. Her hairstyle, her clothes, her favorite foods.
She becomes a real icon in the way that Jacqueline Kennedy was in her day. Her likeness appeared on every conceivable form of pop culture item. Her face was on plates, on cups. In fact, Grover Cleveland tried to have a law passed saying that a celebrity's face could
could not appear on a product without that celebrity's permission. It didn't pass, but it was his attempt to get them out of the popular press.
The title First Lady wasn't coined until the mid-1800s. Some say it was first used at Dolly Madison's funeral in 1849, when President Zachary Taylor called her our First Lady for half a century. By the time Mary Lincoln moved into the White House 12 years later, the phrase had stuck.
The public scrutiny. How long's her skirt? What does her hair look like? Why is she wearing that?
Even Jackie Kennedy, who I think very much wanted to be First Lady, said it's very difficult to lose one's anonymity. And I think that's really what so many of them object to. It's the constant surveillance, the being watched.
Bess Truman did not want to be First Lady at all. In 1944, when Mr. Truman had received the Democratic nomination for vice president, the Trumans were surrounded by reporters. And Mrs. Truman turned to Mr. Truman and she said, Harry, are we going to have to go through this all the rest of our lives?
She's small town Missouri. Bess wanted to play poker. She wanted to drink bourbon with her husband. She didn't want to have to host state dinners.
She had something of a fear that too much public exposure would reveal the very painful fact that her father had committed suicide. At one point, she was kneeling down at the fireplace, burning a stack of letters.
Harry Truman came in and he said, Bess, what are you doing?
And she said, I'm burning all of my personal letters to you.
Truman said, but Bess, think of history. And she said, Harry, I have.
Another reluctant First Lady was Louisa Catherine Adams, the wife of John Quincy Adams.
She was not appreciated by him. She was very instrumental in his rise, but he never seemed to recognize what she did for him.
She was told not to express her opinions. And so she, in a sense, retreated in large part to her room where she wrote a lot of melodramatic and rather bitter poetry and plays, eating chocolates rather obsessively.
Jane Pierce didn't want her husband to go into politics at all. Jane Pierce was exceedingly religious and had a feeling that politics was the devil's work. She had one son. Two other children died at a young age, and she had this one son, Benny, that she just doted on. When Franklin Pierce was running for the presidency, she prayed, and Benny prayed with her, that he would lose.
He's told her all year that he's really not gonna be a candidate, and then sure enough, after he tells her that he won't be elected, he is elected, and she faints.
Several weeks before the inauguration, she and her husband and their son were on the railroad in New England when the train went off the tracks, and before her very eyes, she saw her last remaining son decapitated.
And she never recovered from this tragedy. This was God's judgment and punishment on them for their involvement in political life. Jane Pierce just couldn't handle it. In the White House, she just stayed upstairs, and she was actually a little unbalanced. She spent her time writing letters to her dead son. Helen Taft did have ambitions to be in the White House. She had visited
the White House as a young girl and predicted that she would return as First Lady. When she married William Howard Taft, he was an up-and-coming lawyer.
There were rumors that her husband was going to be appointed to the Supreme Court. But she made an appointment to talk to President Theodore Roosevelt. And after the meeting was over, Theodore Roosevelt wrote to William Howard Taft and said, "After a meeting with your dear wife, I understand why an appointment to the court is not desired at this time."
So poor Taft, she pushed him and pushed him. And at one point during his campaign for president, he said, "Politics makes me sick." he just really didn't want it.
She was the first to ride with her husband in the inaugural carriage from the inauguration at the Capitol back to the White House. She said, "You know, I will take my rightful place beside my husband."
When he was in the White House, he didn't enjoy his 4 years. He consoled himself by overeating. He became our fattest president ever.
First ladies have had all sorts of various rivalries. When Edith Wilson was giving the traditional tour of the White House as the outgoing First Lady to the incoming First Lady, Florence Harding, she found Mrs. Harding too heavily rouged and too loud and too bossy for her take, and finally just turned Mrs. Harding over to the housekeeper.
Julia Grant was rather plain and dumpy. She was cross-eyed, in fact. Grant was content to be general, but Julia always felt that he was destined for greater things. Mary Lincoln said outright to Julia Grant something like, "You'd like to be in the White House yourself, wouldn't you?" Julia Grant tried to turn it aside, and Mary Lincoln said, "Oh, you'd better take it if you could get it. It is very nice."
It was fueled by jealousy. I think Mary did not want anybody to become First Lady and eclipse her.
It is ironic, though, that on the night that when they went off to the American cousin, Mary had sent a note to Julia Grant asking them to come with them. And Julia Grant said later that she would never go to the theater with Mary Lincoln, and so was therefore saved from this possible assassination.
Julia Grant did intend to get to the White House, and she encouraged Grant to run, and when he was finally elected and they went to the White House, he said to his wife, "Well, I hope you're satisfied now." And she was. She had a wonderful 8 years in the White House. She just loved it.
I think maybe Barbara Bush always thought that Nancy Reagan really wasn't the kind of person that belonged there. Barbara Bush came from the East. Nancy Reagan, as we know, was a Hollywood starlet before she married her husband. And I just can't help but feel that there might have been a little feeling of that.
It's frosty, it's icy, it's political, it's jealousy, it's a difference of style, it's a difference of taste. Nancy never forgave George Bush for calling her husband's economic policies voodoo economics.
They couldn't abide each other. Mrs. Reagan never invited the Bushes to any of the private parties. And for 8 years, that is extraordinary. The Bushes were never invited into the private quarters of the White House, ever.
Barbara Bush was no fuzzy and warm grandmother. I interviewed many people who have never recovered from Barbara's extraordinary ability to cut people dead if they transgress, if they cross a line. She was her husband's most trusted confidant, and also as his sounding board, because she is not a woman who minces words. She lets her husband know exactly what she's thinking and feeling, but she rarely lets the rest of us know.
Bess Truman was one of many first ladies who've helped to edit presidential speeches. After plain-spoken Harry delivered one speech, a friend of Bess's said it was a shame the president had used the word manure several times. "Good Lord," replied Mrs. Truman, "it's taken me years to get him to switch to saying manure."
Had started as a genuine love story, and then Pat Nixon was betrayed by Richard Nixon for his only true love, and that was politics. And we saw her wither in the White House. Even her portrait is sad.
And incidentally, Pat's not a quitter after all.
The turning point had come in 1952 in Nixon's famous Checkers speech, when he used Pat as a political prop.
I should say this, that Pat doesn't have a mink coat, but she does have a respectable Republican cloth coat. And I always tell her that she'd look good in anything.
She did not enjoy being the focus of the speech at all. She found it a humiliating experience.
Pat Nixon found it absolutely sickening that she had to have their private financial affairs publicly disclosed.
I, Richard Billhouse Nixon, do solemnly swear.
In 1969, she took little joy in becoming First Lady.
They didn't even share their first meal in the White House, which is traditionally a festive occasion. She had a tray brought up to her room, and it was downhill from there.
Plastic Pat was a popular image at the time, but perhaps, like many of us, when we're in a situation that we're not crazy about, maybe we've become something different. She was a very warm, very genuine person. But in public, she didn't always come across that way.
Nixon never discussed policy with Pat Nixon. I mean, he was much more prone to talking to Kissinger than he was to talking to his wife.
That tendency became critical during the Watergate scandal, when Republican Party operatives were found to have broken into Democratic Party offices. Fingers began pointing at the president.
Well, I'm not a crook.
The president did not choose to use Pat Nixon as an advisor. She was holed up in the White House in her bedroom and very upset about the whole thing.
Nixon had taped Oval Office conversations implicating him in the cover-up.
What good advice she could have given him, because when she heard about that he was taping conversations in the Oval Office, she said, those weren't meant for anybody but himself. Those are like love letters. They should be destroyed. Words to that effect.
I think that if Nixon had taken her counsel, that it's likely that it might not have played out in the same way, and I really do believe that.
Nixon was forced to resign. And as he gave his farewell address to his staff, there was one last humiliation for Pat.
It was heartbreaking in the East Room. He went into this very dramatic, passionate swan song.
Some knocks, some disappointments, when sadness comes.
And relating basically his life, and spoke about his parents and his saintly mother and so forth, and didn't mention her.
She wasn't acknowledged at all. That had to be very painful for her. They were escorted to the helicopter by Betty and Gerald Ford. And she said to Betty Ford, well, Betty, you're going to see a lot of red carpets like this, and you're going to come to hate them.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
Suddenly, America had a new president and a new first lady.
Betty Ford talked about things that no first lady, especially no Republican first lady, had ever touched with a 10-foot pole. She talked about her children's premarital affairs, their use of marijuana. I'm sure her children were thrilled.
Oh, I'm sure they've tried it. I think children try everything, don't they?
She was like a bottle of champagne that you open and the bubbles come out. She was very open. She was very spontaneous.
Women's liberation is truly the liberation of all people.
Before I sign this, Betty, if you have any words of wisdom or encouragement, you're welcome to speak.
I just want to congratulate you, Mr. President. I'm glad to see you have come a long, long way.
I don't know how to take that.
She believed that the White House was under siege, and the only way to give the White House back to the American people is for her and the president to open it up.
I believe it was 28 days into the Ford administration when it was found that she had breast cancer. She made the decision at that point to go public with it.
It's hard to believe now, and for young women especially, there was a time when you didn't tell anybody if you had breast cancer. It was a taboo subject. So by speaking out on that, she was quite a leader in that issue for removing stigma.
Betty Ford said when she was lying there recovering from her mastectomy and she heard that all these women across America were going in for breast cancer checkups, she said, I realized then how very much power a first lady has.
And the guts that that took is indescribable. I mean, Betty Ford has this great line in her autobiography. Here I am, they're playing Hail to the Chief. You know, and there are all these reporters and all these state dinners, and people are looking at me going, now was it the right one or the left one?
Betty Ford kept breaking taboos even after she left the White House.
Her children finally convinced Mrs. Ford that she had a problem with both drinking and with prescription pills.
She talked about her drug dependence, again, an astonishing subject for a first lady. And the nation was the better for it.
By facing my alcoholism and pill problem, our family and each of us as individuals was strengthened.
And she decided she wanted to give back. And that was the beginning of the Betty Ford Center in Rancho Mirage, California. She was involved with it right from day one with fundraising and administration.
This is Betty Ford, escorted by President Gerald Ford.
She is, I think, now better known than her husband because, of course, there's the Betty Ford Clinic that's named after her.
During the 1860 election, the two main candidates were sharply divided on slavery, but they had at least one thing in common, Mary Lincoln. She had once dated Democrat Stephen Douglas before marrying Republican Abraham Lincoln. During the election campaign, she dismissed the short Douglas as a very, very little giant by the side of my tall Kentuckian.
If a president's spouse has all along had an important role as an advisor or as a strong emotional support, that role is going to come to the fore during wartime.
The wartime first ladies have the opportunity to be heroic and courageous, and certainly Dolly Madison did.
There had been a proud boast by a British admiral that he was going to kidnap Mrs. Madison, take her as a war hostage and parade her through the streets of London.
In 1814, the Redcoats marched on Washington, bent on looting the White House and capturing the First Lady. Dolly saw them coming.
She had been setting up for a state dinner and immediately realized that she had better save as much as she could save before the British got to the house.
She would not leave until she had secured the canvas of the George Washington portrait and saw to it that it was removed from the house and not to get into the hands of the British.
She took a number of state papers and had them all rolled up, and off they went across the Potomac to Virginia.
During the Civil War, Mary and Abe Lincoln would stay up late each night discussing the latest dispatches from the battlefront.
She would wait until he was finished with all his work of the day, and he would come into her room and they would talk together. These two are close. She's intelligent, and there's certainly a fair amount of back and forth between them.
Mary wasn't shy about criticizing Union generals, especially Ulysses S. Grant.
She always referred to him as the butcher, because so many men died under his command. And she continually mentioned that to Lincoln. And he said, but he wins battles.
There were stories about Lincoln getting fed up with how much Mary Lincoln talked to him. He said, I want you to know that women have no influence in this administration. Whether or not he was just being funny or whether he was really fed up with hearing, it's difficult to know.
By 1941, the First Lady was addressing the American people directly.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm speaking to you tonight at a very serious moment in our history.
It was Eleanor's voice we heard first on Pearl Harbor Day, not the president's.
By tomorrow morning, the members of Congress will have a full report and be ready for action.
Eleanor goes on the radio in a regularly national scheduled radio broadcast, tells the country that Pearl Harbor has been bombed, and the faith that she has in women and in young people who will bear the brunt of the battle.
Eleanor Roosevelt, who, while she was sometimes considered a radical, almost a socialist, during the Great Depression, during World War II, when she went overseas to talk with the troops, she was seen as, again, very motherly, and really was seen as a role model for the jobs and responsibilities that other American women had to take up.
Vietnam was horrific for both the Johnsons. They both took the war very, very personally. And the Johnsons had teletypes that went off every time an American plane was shot down.
They were in the White House when they would hear from their bedrooms, hey, hey, LBJ, how many kids did you kill today?
She must have been in anguish, but she never wavered in his, in supporting him and trying to give him some strength.
I believe in them.
Lady Bird would sometimes go down to the basement and get rid of some of her frustrations with a bowling ball. She could never get her husband to do anything like that to relieve his tension.
As time wore on and the Vietnam War worsened, and after all, LBJ had had a heart attack back in 1956, she felt that maybe he was not the one that could pull the country together.
Lady Bird helped persuade LBJ not to run again in 1968.
Accordingly, I shall not seek, and I will not accept the nomination of my party for another term as your president.
For Lyndon Johnson, who lived, breathed, ate politics 24 hours a day, to give up the presidency was an astonishing sacrifice. And Lady Bird was the one who led him to it.
The war on terror is ongoing, but the First Lady's response to the tragedy of 9/11 is a matter of record.
My image of Laura Bush is not the image of the First Lady holding her husband's hand in time of crisis. My Laura Bush is the Laura Bush who came out of Senator Kennedy's education committee hearing. Clearly speaking, you know, from the depths of her soul.
Well, parents need to reassure their children everywhere in our country that they're safe.
And that was a tremendous contribution to the nation.
Laura Bush was, like so many other Americans, stunned, frightened by the events of 9/11. She gave her husband a lot of strength, a lot of support behind the scenes.
Her husband says, "I have the perfect wife. She does not go in the spotlight." That's important to know, because for someone like George W. Bush, the spotlight is his. He does not want a wife who would be his equal or his peer in any way.
We will not tire.
She's unwaveringly loyal to him. She is always watching to see how he's presenting to the public. She takes care of looking at his image on television. Says, "I think you need to tone down the rhetoric sometimes." She may have to tell him again, because he has a tendency to go back into that cowboy swagger of his. Her job is to keep him stable and to help him schedule his days in such a way that he has time for his exercise and time for his sleep. They maintain the same ritual they've had through all their married life, and that's something that's brought them stability throughout their relationship. So I think she provides him that kind of anchor, if you will.
Decades before the Civil Rights Act, Lou Hoover invited a black congressman's wife to tea. She was accused of defiling the White House. In the 1930s, the Daughters of the American Revolution would not let Marian Anderson sing at Constitution Hall. Eleanor Roosevelt resigned from the club and arranged for Anderson to sing at the Lincoln Memorial instead.
White House is not only for ceremonial occasions, it's not only the official office of the presidency, it's home.
Because it's their home, if only temporarily, First Ladies have literally reshaped the White House over the years, expanding it, renovating it, and even saving it from destruction. It has become a most democratic domicile, welcoming leaders and tourists from around the world. Today's White House would be unrecognizable to the first woman who lived there in 1800.
When Abigail Adams moved into the White House, it wasn't even finished. It was still under construction.
And she was horrified, where she would write letters to her daughter saying, "You know, it's really the sickliest mess you can imagine, but don't tell anybody I said that because they'll think that I'm too demanding."
She actually hung her washing in the East Room. That's about all it was good for, I guess.
But before long, official business left little room for the first family.
One time, the president's offices were on the same floor as the family quarters. And there were many instances where office seekers or those who were coming to the White House on official business would wander into the private quarters.
In the 1890s, Caroline Harrison had grandiose plans drawn up for expanding the White House.
Where one wing will be for all the presidential offices, move them out of the physical house proper and house them in what would have been a West Wing. The East Wing was going to be a series of art galleries and botanical gardens. Needless to say, that did not pass Congress. The idea was too grandiose for Congress to fund.
A decade later, Teddy and Edith Roosevelt, with six children, had better luck.
Teddy and Edith come into office at the turn of the new century. Edith insists that all the politicos go out of her house. After all, she has these rambunctious children that she's trying to rear in the White House, and a very flamboyant husband.
The White House was expanded, creating what is now its most famous section of all.
The West Wing was built, and this was where the president's staff and what would eventually become an Oval Office were created, and which to this day is where the senior staff of the president comes to work.
Fire gutted the West Wing in 1929. The blaze was controlled before it could reach the mansion, but the fire foreshadowed the historic home's vulnerability.
When the Trumans moved into the White House, it was falling down. Their daughter, Margaret Truman, played the piano. At one point, the one leg of the grand piano was protruding through the ceiling.
Engineers checked out the old house, and they found out it was in imminent danger of potentially collapsing. Among the plans that were put forth for the renovation of the White House were those that said, you know, tear it down.
And in one of her very few press pronouncements, Bess Truman wrote that she thought that the walls of the White House should be preserved, that they were so strongly associated with American history that you just didn't want to destroy them. And they were preserved, and the White House was rebuilt from the inside out.
The rooms, the interiors, kind of mix and match a lot of reproductions with some of the antiques. And the overall effect was one you might think of as typically 1950s looking. Jackie Kennedy, who knew and studied antiques and who knew history, who knew portraiture, felt that the renovation had done away with a lot of history.
And the process began where they were going to look for original pieces and try to find donors to pay for those pieces. She was looking at the various wallpaper samples that came in and looking at floor plans and making suggestions. And a year after she started the process, many of the rooms were ready to be shown to the country. And when they were, she was involved in a televised tour of the White House.
This is Dolly Madison's sofa. That's Nellie Custis's sofa, George Washington's granddaughter. The most interesting are the pair of chairs by the desk. Not many people know that Mrs. Lincoln sold a lot of furniture after her husband's death because she was destitute. A lot that she'd bought and a lot of earlier furniture. Those chairs are way before Lincoln, either Van Buren or Tyler.
One of the things that she did was to create an international stage for the conduct of politics and diplomacy in which her husband could shine.
She paid great attention to every aspect of the dinners, from seating to cuisine, especially cuisine. She had her own French chef, and once again, she wanted everyone to walk away from the White House feeling that it had been a very, very special experience.
Like Jackie, each First Lady entertained in her own style.
Lucy Hayes entered the White House with her husband, and he owed some of his support to the Prohibition Party.
Lucy Hayes, who is a firm believer in temperance, she refused to serve alcohol at any of the White House gatherings. And many people in Washington society were outraged about this, and they called her Lemonade Lucy.
Some first ladies went to the other extreme.
Mary Lincoln went into the White House preceded by rumors that she's a frontierswoman. She's coarse, she's loud, she's lewd, she's uneducated, none of which, of course, fit Mary Lincoln at all. She felt she had to establish herself as head of these social networks, and in trying to accomplish this goal, she just completely went overboard. And the war had just begun, and here she is with all this lavish entertaining.
The president, he was furious with her at times because he believed that some of the soldiers weren't getting blankets and didn't have enough food. And here she was spending on these flibbertigibs that he disapproved of.
Julia Grant came in after the war at a time when the Republican Party was allying itself with what used to be called the robber barons, the captains of industry.
Mrs. Grant was in many ways a perfect example of that opulent Victorian era, wearing these sort of heavily bustled gowns with fringe and satin that ran riot in all different directions.
A time of corruption and profligacy and luxury and extravagance, and she was to some extent a part of that.
And I want to thank all of you for coming. I know it was kind of a last minute thing. I've been awfully busy with arms control and the INF treaty and the Russians and...
Entertaining in style was politically costly for Nancy Reagan, who ordered new china, paid for by political friends, costing more than $1,000 per setting.
The country goes wacko. I mean, the interest rates are at 16%, unemployment is skyrocketing through the roof, and here we are worried about china for the White House.
Today, the White House is more than just home to first ladies. It serves as their office, too.
That with the people sitting with their spouse.
Going back to the beginning of the 20th century, the first lady had a very small staff. The staff is now probably 15 to 18 people engaged in any number of things, from projects and press to those who do the calligraphy on invitations.
The staff, house, and hostess will continue to change as future first ladies leave their mark on the historic mansion. When the King and Queen of England visited the United States in 1939, Eleanor Roosevelt caused quite a stir. She served them hot dogs. The social elite were horrified, but the King and Queen were reportedly delighted.
These are historic memories, and no first partner, no first lady can ignore these memories.
All too often, the first lady is widowed while in the White House. Four presidents have died of natural causes while in office. Four have been assassinated. It is a sad fact that the risk of assassination comes with the job of president.
Mary Lincoln was frightened by the premonition of her husband, in which he attended his own funeral in the East Room of the White House.
She was very worried about Lincoln. She knew that he was in danger of assassination. It was quite clear. I mean, there were attempts. He was shot at. He got death threats all the time.
Thank you.
She was so devastated by it that she was unable to attend his funeral in the East Room. And it would be several weeks before she found herself able to muster enough strength to leave the house that she had loved so much. In 1850, Zachary Taylor died. Margaret became somewhat hysterical. She had, in fact, predicted that if he was elected president, as she put it, it would be a plot to deprive him of my society and to shorten his life.
They had to ice the body to be on view in the White House, and she kept, you know, taking the ice off the body so that she could get one last look at her husband.
James Garfield had only been inaugurated in March of 1881. Lucretia Garfield, she herself had nearly died in April of pneumonia and was away recuperating when he was shot.
In July 1881, Garfield was shot in the back. The First Lady rushed to his side, where she kept vigil night and day.
He lingered for 2 months, and she was with him when he died in Elberon, New Jersey, at the seaside. She won the praise of the nation and was really held up as an example of idealized American womanhood. Ida McKinley was the third president's wife to lose her husband to assassination.
Ida McKinley has to be one of our most interesting first ladies. You know, she started out a very gutsy young woman, Canton, Ohio. She worked in her father's bank when women didn't do that. And she traveled in Europe, and she married William McKinley, and they had two daughters, both of whom died. Her mother died, and she becomes really an invalid, and it's very difficult to know exactly what was wrong with her. She did have certain seizures in public, and he would just ignore these. I mean, he would throw a handkerchief over her face and keep talking at dinner parties and so forth. But she insisted on being present at most public events.
In 1901, William McKinley visited Buffalo, New York to attend the Pan American Exposition. Soon after delivering a speech, he was shot.
And as he was dying, he evidently said to the aides around him, be careful how you tell her, because most people thought that Ida McKinley, being sickly and so forth, would just fall apart.
She had a little diary that her husband had given her that New Year's of 1901, and she had barely written anything in it, but for some reason on this trip, she scribbled about my dear precious dying.
She pulled herself together and took care of funeral arrangements and so forth, and was amazingly competent.
After his death and funeral, which she managed to get through entirely, she no longer had any more of those seizures.
In 1923, while traveling with the First Lady, President Harding became ill and died. Although it was from natural causes, it sparked rumors nationwide.
That Florence Harding had poisoned him. To spare him from all of the trauma and ridicule and possible impeachment because of the scandals that were then just then coming to light in his administration.
She permitted no autopsy, which some have ascribed to her belief in spiritualism, that the body cannot and should not be touched.
Something odd that happened in the White House after Mr. Harding died.
Mrs. Harding went into the East Room and opened the coffin, where Mrs. Harding began to talk to the corpse of her husband.
Someone who observed this rather bizarre incident said she finished her comments by saying, "No one can hurt you now, Warren."
Mrs. Harding then sought to, as she said, be loyal to Warren's memory. Mrs. Harding burned a large amount of the president's correspondence.
She was concerned that it would show that there had been corruption in the administration, and she wanted really to control his image to the very end.
Something has happened here. We understand there has been a shooting. The presidential car coming up now. We know it's the presidential car. You see Mrs. Kennedy's pink suit. There's a Secret Service man, spread eagle, over the top of the car.
She was in the car that one split second when we see her scrambling away, absolutely shocked and running. You only have that for a few seconds. And then, from then on, you have got a woman who really held the country together for probably the next 3 days.
It would be a difficult set of circumstances for anyone to adjust to. And here it was all happening on the national stage.
She keeps on the blood-spattered suit to remind people of what has happened. In Air Force One, she insists on being in the photograph as a kind of transition of power from the Kennedy administration to the Johnson administration.
When she got back to the White House at 3 o'clock in the morning, she was met by the chief of protocol, and he said to her, "Mrs. Kennedy, what can we do for you?" She said, "Find out how Lincoln was buried."
In fact, they used the exact same catafalque, which had been stored for years in the basement of the Capitol. She rose to that occasion. People had always expected a lot of her, and she expected a lot of herself. She was not allowed to break down. No, she couldn't do that. She had to set an example. In an era that was informed by a fear of communist plots, I think it was crucial in keeping the country together and in ensuring as non-traumatic a transfer of power as was possible.
Like the presidents, first ladies also live in a public eye that is not always friendly. Eleanor Roosevelt received multiple death threats, even well after her White House years. In 1958, the Ku Klux Klan placed a $25,000 bounty on her head to keep her from a speaking engagement on civil rights. Eleanor was not deterred. The unusual stress the first ladies face sometimes leads to unusual and scandalous avenues for guidance. Several first ladies have even looked to the heavens.
Mrs. Reagan has herself written about the fact that after the assassination attempt on her husband, she sought in every way she could to essentially hedge her bets and do whatever was possible to exercise some control, however little it was, over protecting her husband, and she very much felt it was harmless.
When people would go to President Reagan and say, "Now this is the schedule for your trip," his very first thing was, "Did you check with Nancy?" She would then call her astrologer, Joan Quigley, go over absolutely everything.
She would ask me, for instance, what are the best times for the president to do this or that? And I would say this time would be dangerous, or the outcome would be bad at a certain time. And I would just really pick the times that they did things.
Mike Deaver, who was the deputy chief of staff, maintains that nothing really important was changed. But I think to a lot of people, the fact that an astrologer was in any way controlling the schedule of the president of the United States was strange.
I didn't see any great harm to that. And nobody was hurt.
Mrs. Reagan's consulting with an astrologer was not just casual. It was very, very serious. If it's a black day, you can't move the president. If it's a white day, you can move the president and you can schedule him accordingly.
There have been several first ladies who were really interested in the occult. Mary Lincoln felt that the seances that she attended was her way of contacting her dead son.
Spiritualism during the Civil War was not an unimportant thing. Spiritualism offered her a kind of relief from her grief.
Edith Wilson had seen an astrologer, and the seeress, as they used to call them, predicted that Mrs. Wilson would someday marry the President of the United States. But it was really Florence Harding who most heavily depended upon the services of her astrologer, the same one that Edith Wilson used.
Florence Harding wanted her husband to be president very badly. She had qualms about it during his campaign. She consulted a medium. She predicted if he did achieve the White House that he would die in office.
In Mrs. Harding's case, the stars didn't lie.
The White House is not a good place for courtship. In fact, it's a very dangerous place for that. A president in love is a president distracted.
Scandal is never far from power, and some White House scandals have been famously public. One of the most dramatic involved a president using state secrets as a tool of seduction.
Woodrow Wilson was a very emotionally passionate man and apparently did not feel complete without a woman in his life.
Wilson had doted on his first wife, Ellen. A calm and genteel Southerner, she was devoted to her husband.
She more or less made it possible for him to participate in politics in a major way.
Woodrow Wilson was a man who relied very much on the support and love and approval of women. You saw it going back to his relationship with his mother. You then saw it in his relationship with his first wife, Ellen.
After 30 years of marriage, Ellen Wilson succumbed to kidney disease.
When she died in the White House, he was absolutely devastated and just emotionally shattered and wondered how he could go on.
To the point where he wrote, and his doctors even documented, his thoughts about suicide. And here he was, President of the United States, with the First World War breaking out.
But a few months later, he met Edith Galt.
Woodrow Wilson is in love with this not particularly well-educated, quite openly bigoted, and very harshly judgmental jewelry store widow, Edith.
It was really astonishing for this president in love, the way he did use the privilege and the power of the presidency as a courtship tool. He really kind of seduced her with the trappings of the presidency and with his ability to move heaven and earth.
He offered to bring her into the inner workings of the White House. He taught her the secret codes and had her encode and decode messages back and forth from leaders of Europe at a time just before and during the first part of World War I. I cannot imagine how berserk the press and the public would go if a first lady knew secret codes today.
Woodrow Wilson married Edith Galt in December of 1915, just a year and 3 months after the death of his wife.
A marital scandal almost derailed the nation's longest-serving first couple before they even reached the White House. Eleanor Roosevelt discovered that FDR was having a love affair with her own secretary, Lucy Mercer.
She was very hurt, and she offered him a divorce. And right about the same time, her mother-in-law, with whom she had a very difficult relationship, apparently spoke to Franklin and said, if you divorce Eleanor, and at this time they had five children, she said, I will cut you off entirely. If he divorced Eleanor, that would be the end of his political career.
What the Roosevelts did was to figure out how they could live together and be happy. Just because you're not passionate, romantic lovers anymore, that doesn't mean that you don't care about each other, that you can't live together. What it was two great, independent, strong, witty people who had a tremendous obligation, a sense of duty, and courage, and a vision.
In his final years as president, FDR began seeing Lucy Mercer again.
In part, it was Eleanor's doing that he did so. Because she was unforgiving of that long ago breach, she threw herself into becoming sort of first lady to the world and really didn't want to deal with the fact that her husband was a very sick man. Her husband was lonely, he was in a wheelchair, and it was in fact their daughter, Anna Roosevelt, who played go-between between her father, the president, and Lucy Mercer, who came back into his life, who was with him when he died, which was an extraordinarily cruel thing for Eleanor to find out.
I think that they really cared for each other deeply. I think they had some problems making it work as a marriage. But she continued to have that respect for him and was very pleased with many of the things that he did in the White House, very proud of their achievements.
Personal scandals have long been used as political weapons. Two early victims were Andrew and Rachel Jackson.
The thing that plagued Rachel Jackson was the fact that she had been married previously.
To a lowlife named Louis Robards, and she thought she'd gotten a divorce.
And that she was free to marry Andrew Jackson. So they married, and they lived together for 2 years before they discovered that, no, her first husband had not divorced her.
In fact, she was still married to Robards. He had not obtained the divorce, and she was legally and technically a bigamist.
The Jacksons settled their legal issues in 1794. But when Andrew Jackson ran for president in 1828, his enemies resurrected the scandal.
Her husband's opponents would bring up this old scandal and say really horrible things for the time.
They called Rachel Jackson the president's whore, which hurt him deeply.
Mrs. Jackson herself was, of course, devastated by this. As she said, I would rather be a doorkeeper at the house of God then go live in that mansion. In a strange way, she got her wish.
When he was elected, she had a heart attack and subsequently died, and then was buried in the gown which she had picked out to wear to the inaugural ball.
From one inauguration to the next, no one can foresee what role a first lady will take on. Achilles heel, popular emissary, silent partner. The First Lady is judged by her actions and her times.
First ladies have had an instrumental role in the social and cultural and intellectual past of the nation. We certainly couldn't have done without them.
It's the most bizarre volunteer job in the world. It has no job description. There's nothing about it in the Constitution. There's no salary. Nobody's really sure what they want you to do.
Something in some ways more important than politics. It's symbolic.
Even those who did not play a political role have pioneered public roles for women.
And I think that it lets us see that the president is a human person. You may get a sense of what he thinks by the people that he selects in his cabinet. but you get a sense of who he is by the person that he chooses to love.
I think that the role in the future will change as gender roles change, and women, I hope, will be able to be free to do whatever they please.
Someday, you'll be talking about the first man rather than the first lady.
Ah, first gentleman. I don't think that it's that far in the future either.
Somewhere out in this audience may even be someone who will one day follow in my footsteps and preside over the White House as the president's spouse. And I wish him well.